our family Christmas service. We hope you enjoy the best gift ever.
Yeah, I know Finn's not very well at home. So, Finn, you're on camera for next week, brother. Should we give him a round of applause? Good job, my friend. Very good indeed. Now, I'm not quite sure how you're meant to follow up on that one, but welcome everybody to church. It's great to have you with us. Welcome to our community service. We've got some special guests with us today. They're going to be reading for us a little bit later on. And of course, we have our children and our young people who are going to be doing a little show for us later on. We're really looking forward to that. We've had a great time practicing and the songs and things like that. So I know you've all been working really hard on that. And we as a church, we can't wait to watch what you've got for us this year. Thank you so much for coming. And we're going to start with our first carol. It's for everybody to sing. It's a well-known one, so I'm going to ask Bay to come up. She's here. Sister, she's here. Let's give her a round of applause as she comes up. Bless you. Thank you so much. Stepping into the breach, we're going to sing our very first carol. So please stand up if you'd like to and join in with me as we sing Joy to the World, the Lord has come.
Joy to the world, the Lord.
Together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can be gathered together as a family this morning, that all ages of young and old can join together this morning and say, joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be together as your people. And we simply ask this morning that everything that is said and done here this morning would be for you and for your glory. We ask it, Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, as I said, it's a community service, and so we do have some special guests with us in the building today. So I've been searching for the right people to come up the front this morning. I've obviously asked the children, the young people to come up and join me. I'm going to have an interview with someone a little bit later on, but I was thinking it'd be really good if I could tie it into the first nativity. So I started thinking of all the characters I could ask. Well, I don't know many royalty, so I couldn't ask many kings. I didn't really think of any innkeepers or business leaders, but I do have some wise head teachers. Obviously, the work I do going into schools across Swansea, And so I've invited three of them to come up and join us right now. So I'm going to invite Stuart Davis from Danagrai Primary School. I invite Kath Nickling from Wine Wen Primary School. I'm going to ask our very own James Knight from Benhyfryd Primary School to come up and to lead us as they read for us from the Bible, and then James is going to pray for us. So let's give them a Waterfront welcome as they come up, shall we? Thank you.
Everyone. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of Lord of hosts will do this.
The reading is from Luke chapter 1, verse 26 to 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her.
Not sure how well you can remember being in primary school yourself, but when you were in assemblies, you actually were involved. So I want to involve you with the prayer that we're going to do this morning. On the screen you can see, "Thank you for hope and being God with us." I'm going to ask you to join in with the prayer seven times throughout the prayer to say this with me, if that's all right. So let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, you were named by the Hebrews as Emmanuel, meaning God is with us, present right here, now, in this place, in this moment. As we remember the hundreds of prophecies written down over the centuries that you brought to completion, thank you for hope and being God with us. As we think about you being born as a fragile baby, yet escaping any harm from King Herod and becoming our wonder-working Prince of Peace, thank you for hope and being God with us. As we remember the huge armies of angels that sang to the shepherds celebrating the peace that you bring to us, thank you for hope and being God with us. As we think of the world that we now live in and the current things that try and cause us to be afraid, thank you for hope and being God with us. As we realize how good you are and that your plans for us are all good and not to harm us, we pray now for friends and family who may be facing suffering and hardship, things that you have not planned for them. Thank you for hope and being God with us. In this time when we all have different thoughts and feelings about the current pandemic and vaccinations, isolation and freedom of movement, about countries' leaders and about how our country and world should be governed, we thank you for hope and being God with us. At this time where peace is so hard to find because of wars and fake news and staff shortages and challenging finances, stressful lifestyles with so much choice, so many decisions and expectations, so many challenges to living physically and mentally healthy lives, thank you for hope and being God with us. So we come to you with childlike requests this morning, Lord, that over this Christmas, you, Emmanuel, would keep us faithful to you, that our Christmases would be full of peace, hope, and joy, full of you, and that we would be able to share you with people around, to share you your peace, hope, and joy. Amen.
Thank you so much to the three of you for coming up and for reading and praying with us this morning. I know that as a church we're always praying for schools, and we know it hasn't been a very easy time. The last 18 months, if not this last term, has not been easy, and you've all faced those challenges head on to provide education and care for our children in our city. So I know from myself and I know from the church that we are praying for you, not as head teachers, but also as a families as well that you're representing this morning. So we pray for you as a church, and we pray that God will bless you and your schools as you go back to them. Church, we're going to continue our service. We're going to sing once again. We're going to stand and we're going to sing, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King." Let's stand and let's sing for joy at this wonderful carol, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King."
Rise,
wonderful. Thank you so much, Bay, for doing that for us this morning. We are going to have an interview now. I'm going to invite a good friend of mine, and he's going to come forward, and he's going to share with us his story with us this morning. So I'm going to invite James to come up and join me. Should we give him a Waterfront welcome? Bless you, James. Come and take a seat, Brad. I made sure we had the comfy chairs from the cafe. If you're not sure, we've got a cafe. It's called the Juniper Tree Cafe, and it's open Monday to Friday from 9:30 to about 2:30. I think that's a good enough plug, isn't it? Yeah, good. So you'd like to join us for that, you're more than welcome. But James, we brought you up here today, brother. We're very grateful to come to join us. And I've just got another cheap plug for you. If you are interested in stories, in life stories, then we have a podcast called Legacy Tales Podcast. It's available on Spotify and all those lovely places if you're somebody who likes to listen to podcasts. And you can always also find it on the Waterfront website as well, www.waterfrontchurch.org. And so as part of those interviews, I get to chat to people and get to find out a little bit more about them. So I've invited James up here this morning. So James, can you tell us what's your name and where do you come from?
Okay, my name is James Morgan, born in Neath, but spent 32 years in a little town called Broadstairs in Kent, very famous for a writer by the name of Charles Dickens.
Wonderful, very good. So you've obviously traded for the right side of the river now.
Yep.
And we're very grateful you are back and joined us here this morning. So James, tell us, what's your occupation? What do you do for a living?
I'm a teacher too. I teach business studies, so in a private school just outside Cardiff. So yeah.
You notice there was a pause there between between private and school. There was a tiny pause in the middle. I don't know if you picked that up. So we've got another teacher with us this morning. I'm very glad because we love teachers here in Waterfront. So you're a teacher. You do business studies.
Yep.
So what's the age range there?
The school itself is from 3 to 18, but I only teach GCSE and A-level. So that's year 9 and above.
Okay, so they're getting very serious about the subject as well.
Yeah, very serious at the moment with where everything is going on with the government and that, and we're not sure if the exams are going ahead, so yeah.
Yeah, so lots to be doing at the moment,
yes.
Planning and such.
Mocks and that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So you're doing that now, and how long have you been doing that?
Since 2005. So
2005?
Yeah.
Okay, doing it quite a while now then.
Yeah, yeah.
And so let's travel back then, shall we? Let's go as far back as we can. What's your earliest memory of church?
Being brought up in Neath Ealing, and I remember kind of being a big Star Wars fan, going to church and taking my Star Wars toys to play in the pews and running around after church or over the pews, but that was my earliest kind of memory of church.
Okay, so a lot of what ours do now, you were doing it then.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so that's your earliest memory of church then. So what's family life then? Because obviously you went to church.
Yes,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
So what's family life like then?
My family or?
Your family, yeah.
Well, brought up with Christian parents, went to church every Sunday. My dad went into the ministry himself, so was... Life was church for a long period of time. Got married and I had 3 children myself. Continued to go to church and then personal circumstances changed and that stopped.
Okay. So can I just come back then? You are a pastor, you're officially a pastor's
kid. Pastor's son, yeah.
Okay. What's the one positive about being a pastor's kid? There must be one, right?
Knowing everything.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Because the answer is usually yes or Jesus,
yeah.
Right? Okay, good. Very good. And what's the hardest thing you found being a pastor's kid?
Having to behave a certain way.
Okay, all right. So you found that difficult?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So you've been a pastor's kid. You're obviously, your family's going to church. You're
yep.
running around on Sunday mornings. Yep. You're then picking things up and listening to things.
Yep.
So what's the earliest thing you remember about being told about Jesus then?
It probably was this. Probably was the Christmas story and being involved in all the plays and everything that goes on with Christmas, getting dressed up. And I hate dressing up, so for me it's the worst thing, but that's probably why I remember it the most.
I'll duly noted for next year.
Yeah, I know.
We'll make sure that happens. Bless you. Okay, so you've heard about Jesus then. So what translates then between then and then keeping going to church, and now you're obviously back and you're doing lots of things in our church. So something's happened in the middle.
Yeah. As I said, I got married very young and personal circumstances changed, and in 2012 I left the church, but also parted company with my then ex-wife, and decided to take a break. And then I was away somewhere, and I went to a Remembrance Day service where they did communion, and the person I was with said, "Oh, let's go do communion." And I went, "No, I can't do that, because it actually means something. And unless I put myself right before God, I couldn't do communion." And from that moment onward, I had a kind of real kind of thing in my life that I wanted to go back to church. And then one thing led to another, and in February 2020, I found myself back in Wales, and then found myself back in church.
Okay, so you found yourself back in church. You actually found yourself back in this church.
This church, yes.
So what was your first impression of us then?
Very welcoming. I had been here a few times, so I did know a fair few people. So it was, I felt like I'd come home. It sounds a bit stupid. It felt like I was back home again. So
sure. You felt very comfortable
yeah.
sitting there. Okay. And what did you take away from that first visit?
Honestly, the first time, nothing. It was the second time I came, and a real kind of feeling of wanting to recommit my life to God.
So. Right, so what do you mean then by recommitting?
Just asking him to forgive me for everything I'd done wrong, but also being a Christian is not just a name term, if you like. It's actually a living experience, and things like reading the Bible and getting to know him better through reading the Bible.
Okay, so can you describe that event for us? It was here?
It was here, yeah.
So can you tell us, can you like remember the songs?
Not the songs. I remember walking into the service, and every song we sung, I cried. And I remember, I can't remember the guy's name, he was preaching, and I remember just going, "God, if this is for me, you'll make the minister make a call forward." And he did. At the end of the service, he made that call forward. And I went to take that step forward, to come forward, and my legs went. They went to jelly, I couldn't feel them. The last time I had that experience was my driving test. And I walked to the front, and Pastor Warren came down the front and prayed for me. And we spent a bit of time praying, crying, praying, crying. But yeah, it's good.
Okay. And as you say, you've recommitted. You're recoming back to Jesus, and you've given your life back to him, as it were. So tell us then, that was 2020?
Yeah, so March 20, just literally, I think it was a fortnight before lockdown.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a time to do it, isn't it? Okay, so that must have been very difficult to go from saying, right, I am giving my life back to Jesus, I know he's forgiven me for the wrong things I've done, I'm coming back to him, I'm coming back to church, I want to read my Bible, I want to get involved with people in church, and then you can't.
Yeah, exactly.
That was a really good timing on your part.
Yeah, always, but in some ways it gave me time to reflect. And I know it sounds stupid, but I had time to sit and think about what I'd done wrong, also spend a bit of time reading the Bible, and working from home, which was not great. Teaching from home I would never recommend, but there you go.
You've told me lots of stories about you trying to teach from home with various monitors and laptops and things like that. But now you're obviously back with us, and coming each week, and you're getting involved in a men's ministry and leading that for us, which is really exciting. So hopefully in the new year, God willing, there'll be new plans out there. So have that in your mind ready. James is coming for you.
Yep.
He wants you to be involved. And so that's now.
Yep.
Obviously, this podcast is called the Legacy Tales Podcast. So I wonder, you've obviously got children. How old are they now?
25, 23, 21.
Okay.
Not really children.
So what I would love to know is, obviously, there's going to be that one day where, you know, whether it's going to be a Facebook post by then, I'm not entirely sure. But the news is going to come out that James Morgan has gone to be with the Lord. He's passed away. What would you like your legacy to be? I'm not trying to be morbid. I'm trying to say, is that at least a question? What would you like people to remember you for?
Okay.
What would you like your legacy to be?
I think my legacy would like to be that I loved everyone. I treated everyone the same, but also that I was there for everyone. I think a lot of my friends around always say to me, you were there for me. Whenever I needed you, you were there for me. And therefore, for me, it's like I can show God's love through what I do. And they know that through, you know, it's strange. People say to me, oh, do people know you're a Christian in school? I said, yeah, because A, it is a Christian school anyway, it's a Catholic school, but the amount of times I've had the opportunity to talk to people and share why I'm slightly different, I don't do the same things they do, that sort of sure. thing.
So. Okay. So you want to be the one who loved people yes. because God loved you?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Now then, one final question for you then.
Okay.
I would love to take you back in time. You love Star Wars.
Yeah,
you love Star Wars. You know, you love all the sci-fi stuff. So yeah. I want you to imagine you're now able to travel back in time. You're able to talk to the young James Morgan. He goes to church, he runs around, he plays with toys, yeah. he's heard about Jesus through the nativity play. Yes. What would you like to tell him, if you could?
Don't lose faith. Don't lose it.
Okay.
But believe. Continue to, I suppose, trust yourself, but trust God as well.
Yeah. Okay. Wonderful. On that note, should we give James a massive round of applause? If you're here this morning and that story kind of hits home with you, perhaps you did used to come to church, perhaps you did used to be that child who used to run around playing with their Star Wars toys in church, perhaps you have got away and you think, oh, I'm too far away, then I hope James's story this morning helps you to remember that there's no such thing as being too far away, because we believe in a God of love, and the God who loves us is the one who sent Jesus to die on that cross for us. And if you can change the life of James Morgan, then listen, there's hope for us all, isn't there? So if you want to find out more, talk to James, talk to myself. If you come with somebody this morning, they would love to share with you how Jesus has changed their life. And as I said, if you'd like to listen to more stories over Christmas and do a binge listen, then the Legacy Tales podcast has lots of other life stories, including our own Meg Conway as well. So if you want to listen to those life stories, I can highly recommend that to you. It's called Legacy Tales Podcast, or if you jump on our church website, waterfrontchurch.org/sermons, you will find it on there as well. But once again, should we give James another round of applause? That was excellent. Thank you, James. Now then, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for the main event. I'm going to invite the children to come forward so they can get ready for their parts. They've been training for the last 3 weeks or more, trying to put this together. We are very, very excited for what they're going to bring for us this morning. So if you guys can come forward and get yourselves into position ready. Excellent, well done. We've got a lovely little show to put on for you this morning. We're very excited. There you are. As they get into their positions, should we just give them some encouragement this morning? We've got wise men, we've got shepherds, we've got innkeepers, we've got a very angry king, because we want to present to you this morning a wonderful story for you this morning, and it's called The Best Gift Ever. I'm going to go and get my Bible, I'm going to get my chair, I'm going to sit down, and I'm going to tell you the whole story. If you can move it on for me, Chris, that would be great. Lovely.
Well, it's a packed house. Can't keep those animals out. We got kings, shepherds, and angels all around. We're waiting for something. It's about to unfold. The greatest story ever told. Put your gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
coming and being part of our community service here this morning. This year, Waterfront Kids are going to tell you the story of the best gift ever.
We have shepherds, we have wise men, and we have so much more. So let me pull up my chair and tell you the whole story. In the days of the Bible, a promise had been written that one day God would send a king who would change the whole wide world. The 400 years of waiting were over with another surprising announcement. Emperor Augustus is requesting all the people of his kingdom return to their place of birth to register. The king said,
"What?"
The innkeeper said,
"Money, money, money."
Thank you, that was my bit. The shepherd said,
"Sorry."
During those days, an angel appeared to Mary.
"You will have a son, call him Jesus. He will save his people from their sins."
The angel also came to Mary's fiancé, Joseph, and told him not to worry.
"Don't worry about the thing. This is all part of God's amazing plan."
With that, Joseph took Mary and then travelled hundreds of miles all the way back to Bethlehem town. They did it very slowly. They travelled all around until they got themselves to Bethlehem town. Breaking news. Magi from the east have been studying their books when a humongous star turns up in the night sky. From their studies, this tells them that a king is going to be born. So, with their supplies at hand, they set off to find the new baby king. The king says,
"What? A new king? No way."
The innkeepers say,
"Money, money, money."
The shepherds say,
"What?
Stop.
Sorry."
Back in Bethlehem town, Mary and Joseph search for a place to stay. In all the busyness, there's often no room for the saviour of the world.
"Hang on, I do,"
said the final innkeeper.
"It's not much to do for one night."
So, in the middle of an animal shed, in the back of someone's inn, the saviour of the world is born into the world. The shepherds said this. The king said,
"I walked and you..." Oh. Get rid of him. There's only room for one king, and that's me."
The shepherd said,
Here's the news.
The shepherds were out on the hillside when they heard the angels singing.
"Glory to God, peace on earth. Glory to God, peace on earth."
The angels directed the shepherds to a small stable. And there they came to worship the baby king. There's no baby. We can edit that bit out, can't we? Next week they're going to ask, "Why are you all laughing at that bit?" That wasn't in the script, by the way. The angels directed the shepherds to a small stable, and there they came to worship the baby king. Sometime later, the magi arrived, bringing with them the gold, frankincense and myrrh as gifts for God's special king. The magi said,
"Gold for a king, frankincense and perfume,
Amen. For what he'll do in the future.
This is the gift of Jesus. He's finally come into the world. The one who can heal broken hearts, remove our sin, and transform our lives forever by dying on a cross and rising from the dead. It is the best gift ever told, best story ever told, because it's true. He can still change lives even today. So why not this Christmas receive this amazing gift and have your life transformed forever? And if you are a Christian, then why not follow the example of the Magi and the shepherds who went on the mountains, over the hills and everywhere, telling them of the best gift ever, that Jesus Christ is born. Do you know what, gang? I feel a song coming on, do you?
Yeah!
Good, let's play the song. Didn't they do an amazing job?
Yes.
You were absolutely brilliant. Should we get, let them have a bow? Come on, take a bow. You are all absolutely amazing. As I said, we've been working really hard upstairs the last couple of weeks. If you've been hearing stomping during the services, or you're wondering why there's a banging in the audio of the online services, we're the reason why. We've been working really hard, but you've all done such an amazing job. Thank you so much. You can come down now. Should we give them another round of applause as you come down? Come on, the new lot. Absolutely amazing. As I said, we've been working on that for a good couple of weeks now, and we are so proud of them that they're able to come up and show for us what Christmas is really all about. I'm just going to spend a couple of more minutes with you. I hope you bear with me, and we're going to read the Bible together. I'm just going to explain a little bit what Christmas means for me. And we've had James explain what Christmas means to him. James Morgan and James Knight have prayed for us and talked about Christmas and what it's really like for them. And so I'm just going to take a few more minutes to talk about the best gift ever. Because I don't know about you, but this Christmas is going to be quite different for many of us, isn't it? As we navigate the latest guidance from Westminster and Cardiff. And it'll be doubly so for us as a family, because it'll be the final time for us as a family of four because in February, God willing, we are due baby number 3. Is going to make an appearance in February. And like most parents, we're now doing that thing of desperately searching for a name. So we are going through countless websites and looking at baby books, looking for an appropriate name for our child, and of course, looking at the meaning of their names as well. So I did a little bit of research before I came out, and I've discovered what people's names actually mean. So our pastor, his name is Arnallt, Arnie to most of us, because that's what we can pronounce. His name means this. Arnallt, I don't know if you knew this, brother. Your name means eagle ruler. That's what your name means. Sounds very elegant, doesn't it? Yes. He is an eagle ruler, apparently. One of our Sunday school teachers, he comes up and tells us some amazing Bible stories for us. He used to be a deputy head teacher as well, funny enough. His name is Kerith. Are you here, brother? You are here. Do you know what your name means? No. Oh, well, I did some research. Your name means cutting. So don't cross him, is my advice. In the Bible, of course, there's a Kerith in the Bible. And in the Bible, it's the name of a brook that flows out of the Jordan River. So that's a very biblical name as well, Kerith. Then we're going to have a girl come up for us. She's one of our young people. Her name is Abby or Abigail. And I discovered that Abby means cause of joy. That's very sweet, isn't it? And I'm sure to Sue and Paul Ashman, who are watching this next week, I'm sure she really is a cause for joy as well. Then I looked for another one of our elders. He comes up here and leads our services often. His name is Trevor. Are you here, brother? You're here. Do you know what your name means?
It's a Welsh name.
It is a Welsh name, yes. Fireman Sam famously. But your name actually means this. From the big village. That's what your name means. So from the big village of Morriston, we present Trevor to you this morning. And when we were trying to pick names for our boys, we have Isaac. His name means the one who brings laughter. And being your dad, Isaac, you do bring a lot of laughter into our house, don't you? Yes. And very modest about it, he is as well. And then we have Malachi. Well, Malachi means God's messenger. That's what those names mean. You see, the names we give to our children and their meaning are really important to us. There are certain names that, no matter who we are, where we come from, there are certain names we stay away from, because not only do they mean something quite odd, but actually somebody famous has had that name and they're not so good, so we stay away from those names. But as we take a look at the first nativity, we see that names and their meaning are very important. In our play, we had the angel visiting Joseph on that very first encounter. And when you read the story in the Bible, we see that the name, the meaning, and the life purpose of the child are all spelt out to this very unexpected dad-to-be. We read it in Matthew chapter 1. And this is what it says. And her husband, Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, don't fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Amazingly, as you read that, I read that once again and I realized something. Joseph had already thought up of a plan. You see, Joseph could see the situation in front of him and he'd been trying to desperately work out the best move forward. To do it quietly, not to upset Mary, not to put her to shame so that nobody else knew, but do it quietly and do it quickly. Joseph had a plan to deal with the situation of how to best to handle it. But amazingly, we see in that little passage, God had other ideas. And I don't know about you, but the lesson I've learned over the last couple of years is this. We make an awful lot of plans, but not many of them come off. You see, often we plan, we scheme, oh, we'll do this, we'll do that on that day, and we'll do this on another day, and oh, in a few months' time we'll do that as well. And we plan, and we scheme, and we think, and we write it down. But I want you to know this morning, no matter what plans we have, whether it's for Christmas, whether it's for our family, whether it's our five-year plan, whatever it might be, God has other ideas. Joseph already thought about it in his mind. I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and it's all going to work out fine. And then God entered and changed all the plans. But also notice that in this plan of God's, everything is spelled out. Nothing is left off the table. Joseph is told absolutely everything about this child. The miraculous child's name, its meaning, and mission are all laid out for Joseph. The angel tells him, doesn't he? The angel says, she shall bear a son. Call him Jesus. That's his name. For he will save his people from their sins. The meaning and the life purpose of Jesus. Because Jesus means God saves. And he does save people. He saves people from their sins. That's what the angel told Joseph. And as Christians, that's what we still believe today. That even though we do things wrong, even though we say things wrong, we do things wrong, we know deep down if we had to face an almighty God, we couldn't get there. There's nothing that you and I can do. But that's why Jesus came as the best gift ever. The best gift ever who can truly transform lives. See, it tells us clearly in the Bible that God cares about us and he loves us and he knows everything about us, even our names. In fact, it even says in the Bible he knows the number of hairs on our head, which I know is easier for some of us than others. But no matter who we are this morning, no matter where we've come from, no matter how far we've gone, as James reminded us earlier, no matter how far away we think we've walked away from God, the Bible does tell us people mess up. People do things wrong. So God was going to solve the problem of sin by coming down among us. That's what Emmanuel means. God with us. God in the flesh, in the form of Jesus Christ, with that one sole goal mission in mind. To save his people from their sins. And he did that. He's already completed that work by dying on a brutal and horrible Roman cross and from rising from the dead. And he did it to provide this best gift ever. So that no matter who we are or where we come from, no matter what we've said or done, the Bible says, as we've been reminded already this morning, no matter how far away we think we've gone, we can come back. We can come to God and we can say sorry for the things that we've done wrong. And we can say to this God that we believe and trust that he really did die on that cross. And he really did come back to life again for the wrong things that we've done wrong. And the amazing thing is that this gift is open not just to certain people from a certain area. No, this gift is for everyone. No matter who we are, where we come from, what our job might be, he came for all people, so that when we place our faith and trust in him, he takes away our sin. He removes the guilt and the shame, and he replaces it with peace and joy in our hearts. You see, each Christmas, we tend to look at the presents that are under the tree, don't we? We look at the label. We see who gave it to us. We might even try and feel it. What does it feel like? We try to guess what it is before we even open it. If it's soft and squidgy, we know that's probably socks. If it's hard and cold, it's deodorant. But I want you to imagine this year, there is a gift at the bottom of your tree. And it's labeled to you, love from God. It's the gift of knowing a real Christmas. Not just the Christmas of the tinsel and the turkey. A real Christmas of knowing Jesus, of knowing his life and his mission, and knowing that deep in your heart and in your life. And I wonder if you had that gift at the bottom of your tree, I wonder what your reaction would be.
would you leave it unwrapped for another year? Will you leave it unopened? Or this year, will you open it? And will you discover the amazing truth that this gift is not just for Christmas, but this gift could transform your life forever? You see, for me, back in Christmas of 2000, I'd received many gifts that Christmas, but something still wasn't quite right. You see, I realized I still did things wrong. I said things wrong, I thought things wrong, I watched things wrong, I did things that were wrong, and I knew that it would separate me from God. But by talking to a friend who gave me these really encouraging words, in capital letters, she wrote this: "You know the gospel, you need to do something about it." Probably not the most encouraging words you've heard this Christmas. "But you know about Jesus," she said. "You know that he died on a cross and came back to life again. You know all of this. Well, if you do, do something about it." So in 2001, after that conversation, I did. I prayed to God for, perhaps honestly, really for the very first time. I was sorry for the things that I had done wrong. I was sorry for the sin that I had done. And I asked God to forgive me. I believed that he died on a cross for me. And I wanted to commit my life to him. And you know, I can only describe it like this. I had such a weight on my back. It was like the heaviest backpack I'd ever had over all the guilt and shame that I had had in my life. And in that moment, as I said to Jesus, "I'm sorry for the things that I've done wrong. I believe you died on the cross for me and I want to commit my life to you," it's almost as if somebody came behind me, cut off the cords of the backpack, and it fell off. And friends, I can honestly say I've never felt that shame and that guilt again. Why? Because I believe this Jesus provides the best gift ever, of sins forgiven, of a guilty conscience cleansed, of the guilt and the shame that we've done taken away. And he brings peace and brings joy into the hearts of those who love him. Hallelujah. What a saviour. You see, I can sum up my story like this. It's not what you know, because James and I can tell you, usually the answers are yes and Jesus. It's not what you know, it's who you know. And his name is Jesus. And I truly believe that this Christmas, he is the best gift ever. The one who came to save his people from their sins by dying on a cross and coming back to life again. And if you want to come and find out more, I would love to talk to you more about how Jesus can change your life this Christmas and you can have this best gift ever. But as a challenge to Christians here this morning, I want to tell you this. If you're a Christian in the building this morning, why not take this Christmas to tell everybody who will listen to you? Why not go over the mountains, over the hills, everywhere you go? And why not tell them that Jesus Christ is born? Why not tell them of the best gift ever? Because when you tell your story, as you tell others about Jesus, you have no idea the true impact it'll make. For me, it was in Christmas in 2000. This year, why not make Christmas 2021 the year you have had your life changed forever? Because of Jesus. As I said, if you'd like to find out more, please come and find me at the end. Or if you came with a Christian, why not talk to them and get them to tell you their story as well. But God bless you, and thank you very much for listening this morning. We're going to close our service this morning. I hope we've had a great time at church, have we? Yeah. Five of us have, that's all right then. It's been great to have you with us, and I just want to thank again our head teachers. We give them another round of applause. Bless you. Thank you. And to James Morgan as well for coming in. Bless you, man. And of course, to our amazing children and young people as well. Let's give them a round of applause as well. You were excellent. Bless you. And I don't know about you, but I love that song so much. I'm singing those songs everywhere I go. And I guarantee you, when you go home for your lunch, you are going to be singing our final song. We're going to sing that final song that the children brought for us. Go tell it on the mountains, over the hills, and everywhere. Tell it on the mountains that Jesus Christ is born. We're going to sing it all together as a church. And if you want to join in with the actions, we would love that as well.
As part of our final song, we're going to have collection as well this morning. If you're a visitor, please feel quite free to let the basket pass you by. But if you're part of this church and you'd like to give as part of the things that we're doing here as a church and over Christmas, please do that as well. And if, as I said, if you'd like to find out anything else that's going on in the life of the church over Christmas, head over to our website, which is waterfrontchurch.org, and you should find everything you need on there. But Chris, I think everyone wants to sing this song. So let's stand up on our feet. Let's clap along. If you want to do the actions, join in. And then I'm going to invite Kerith to come and close our service this morning.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere.
I can identify more with the definition of Kerith, the brook Kerith in the Bible, that went on and on and on and on during the drought, because I tend to go on and on and on. But now you know I have a darker side. Let us pray. Father, we just thank you this morning for the privilege and the pleasure we had of a glimpse of the true meaning of Christmas this morning. We pray your blessing on every contributor and every contribution, and all who have heard the message, the real message of Christmas. As we are privileged to enjoy the feast and festivity of Christmas, which surely we will, we think of those who are less fortunate than ourselves. We think of the sick, those who are physically and mentally sick, those who are lonely, those who are homeless, those who are marginalized by society. But we pray mainly this morning for those who do not know you as their Lord and Savior. May they find the best gift this Christmas time, to come to know you, your amazing love, and your abounding grace. To know you as Redeemer, Savior, constant companion, faithful friend, and coming King. Father, we give you thanks this morning. It's so little we have to give for what you have done for us. We pray that people will find that the true meaning of peace on earth and peace in their soul is firstly giving glory to God. When none was found to deliver me, Jesus came, praise his name. When hope and trust had deserted me, Jesus came, praise his name. Faith in him was the remedy, blood the glorious victory. Let earth and heaven aloud proclaim, Jesus came, praise his name.
Stable for a throne, and he.